welcome back to OMFS lecture series. Today we shall be discussing condylar fractures under the headings anatomy of TMJ, mechanism of condylar injuries and classification of condylar fractures. Let's have a quick look at the anatomy of temporomandibular joint. TMJ basically has two components, a passive component and active component. Passive components are the glenoid fossa, which is a part of the temporal bone, condyle, which is part of the mandible, and articular eminence, capsules and ligaments, and articular disc. These five are the passive components of TMJ, of which the glenoid fossa, condyle, and articular eminences are made up of bones or heart tissue. And the capsules and ligaments and the disc are made up of soft tissue. The active components of temporomandibular joint are the muscles of mastication. All the muscles of mastication. The temporalis muscle, medial and lateral pterygoid and masseter. All these fall under the active components of TMJ. TMJ is formed by the mandibular condyle fitting into the mandibular fossa, and the two bones are separated by articular disc. The different capsular and ligament attachments are the fibrous capsule. Fibrous capsule or the joint capsule covers the entire joint. Temporomandibular or lateral ligament. It extends from the zygomatic process to the lateral aspect of condylar head. Sphenomandibular ligament is an accessory ligament that extends from the spinosphenoid to the tip of lingula on the medial aspect of the ramus. Stylomandibular ligament is the fourth ligament which extends from the styloid process to the posterior border of ramus at the angle region. So these four structures have attachments to and around the TMJ, and their main function is to control the excessive movement or to guide the direction of the condylar head and articular disc during the movement or functioning of TMJ. In the lecture on basics of management of mandibular fractures, we had seen how elevators and depressors act on a fracture to displace it. Lateral pterygoid has direct attachment to the anterior part of the neck of the condyle at the pterygoid fovea, and it can displace the fractured condylar head anteriorly and medially. The condylar head is a semi-cylindroid process which is 15 to 20 millimeters in length and 8 to 10 mm in thickness. The long axis of the condyle is related to the position of the ramus of mandible and not to the skeleton. It is not related to the skeletal axis, but it is related to the ramus of the mandible. The angle formed by the two condylar axes varies between 145 degree to 160 degree. This is an axial section of the CT showing cross sections of condyles on both the sides. So it is told that it is found out that the two condyles meet at the foramen magnum at an angle of 145 to 160 degrees. The vascular supply to the TMJ arises anteriorly from the mesenteric artery and posteriorly from the branches of superficial, temporal and maxillary arteries. All these are the branches of external carotid artery. The nerve supply to the joint is from the auriculotemporal nerve with some additional innervation from mesenteric nerve and deep temporal nerves. These diagrams depict the anatomical and histological differences between the condylar heads of a child and an adult. As you can observe, the cortical bone thickness at the condylar head in a child is very less when compared to that in an adult. The periosteum of the condyle facing the joint is in its active osteogenic state in a child, whereas it has moved to the latent osteogenic state in an adult. Condylar neck in a child is broader with thin articular surface. Therefore, an impact at the condyle will confine the fracture within the capsule, or it is called intracapsular fracture with hemarthrosis, meaning bleeding and swelling within the joint. This carries a high risk of progressing into TMJ ankylosis. On the other hand, in an adult, the condylar neck is relatively narrow and the articular surface is thicker. Hence, an impact to the condyle will result in extracapsular fracture with normal vascularity. Injury to the condyle may be caused by a variety of mechanisms. Lindahl divided traumatic forces causing condylar injury into three categories. The first is energy imparted on a static individual by a moving object. For example, a blow to the face by a fist or a bat or any other object. The second type of force is that of a moving individual striking a static object, such as a child falling and hitting the chin against the pavement. This mechanism is also seen in parade ground fracture, wherein a standing soldier collapses, hits the chin onto the ground and fractures his condyle or mandible. The third classification is energy developed by a combination of the first two mechanisms. This type of force is typical of that generated during an automobile accident, in which the individual is moving forward and the object is moving in the opposite direction. For example, where a person is moving in a car and hitting his chin across the dashboard. There have been many studies into the resistance of mandible. This diagram shows the deformation of bone by an applied force. When a force causes compressive strain at one side, it gets converted into tensile strain at another. It was found that bones fracture at sites of tensile strain because their resistance to compressive force is greater. Studies by Hulk and Hodgson showed that isolated mandible is liable to particular pattern of distribution of tensile strain when forces are applied to it. Anterior forces applied to the symphysis menti, the mental foramen or mandibular body gets converted into strain at condylar necks and the lingual plates on the contralateral side. The areas in red denote the force applied and the areas in blue denote the resultant tensile strain. The subcondylar fracture, as you can see in this diagram, is usually a result of indirect violence to the mental prominence or the contralateral body of mandible. As you already know, the masseter has insertion at the lateral aspect of ramus. The medial pterygoid has insertion at the medial aspect of ramus and lateral pterygoid is inserted at the pterygoid fovea at the anterior neck of condyle. So usually a subcondylar fracture is evident just superior to the insertion of masseter. Therefore, a coordinated action of the masseter and the pterygoids will displace the condylar head in supero anterior and medial direction. Moving on to classification of condylar injuries. There are basically three types of injuries seen in temporomandibular joint. They are contusion, dislocation and fracture. Contusion involves soft tissue injuries like that to ligaments, muscles, synovium, and may cause formation of inflammatory exudates or hemarthrosis. A tear in meniscus can also result in osteoarthritic changes. Dislocation is a displacement of the condylar head completely out of the glenoid fossa, which usually cannot be reduced by the patient. There is one more term associated with it. It is called subluxation. In subluxation, patient can reduce the displaced condylar head himself. And fracture can either be intracapsular, that means within the capsule, like seen in majority of condylar fractures in children, and also extracapsular or subcondylar fractures as seen in adults. Different classification systems have been given by various authors. Here we shall be discussing two such systems in detail. The first system was given by Lindahl in the year 1977. He proposed a system that classified condylar fractures based on several factors, like based on anatomic location of the fracture, based on the relationship of the condylar segment to the mandibular fragment, and based on the relationship between the condylar head and glenoid fossa. Let's see each of them in detail. Based on anatomic location of the fracture, he classified condylar fractures into fractures of the condylar head, condylar neck, and subcondylar fractures. The condylar head is usually defined as the portion of the condyle superior to the narrow constriction of the condylar neck. Fractures of the condylar neck are intracapsular, means it is within the confinement of the fibrous capsule. The next classification is that of condylar neck. The neck is the thin constricted area located immediately below the condylar head. Therefore, it is extracapsular. Any fracture at or below the condylar neck is considered extracapsular fracture. Subcondylar fracture. So, subcondyle is the region located below the condylar neck and extends from the deepest point of the sigmoid notch anteriorly to the deepest point along the concave posterior aspect of the ramus. So, depending on the location, these fractures are described as high or low subcondylar fractures. Now, based on the relationship of condylar segment to the mandibular fragment, fractures are classified as undisplaced or non-displaced. That means even if there is a fracture, the condylar head doesn't displace itself. So, this is undisplaced fracture. Deviated. This involves only an angulation of the condylar fragment in relation to the mandibular segment. As you can see in the diagram, there is only a little bit of angulation of the condylar fragment. The fractured ends remain in contact with no separation or overlap. This is deviated fracture. Displacement with medial or lateral overlap. Here the fractured ends of the condylar segment lies either medially or laterally to the displaced or the distal mandibular segment. Medially displaced condylar fragment is more commonly seen. Displacement with anterior or posterior overlap. As you can see in the diagram here, the condylar head is displaced anterior to the mandibular segment. Or it can be displaced posteriorly also, but it is very rare. And the sixth type is no contact. Here there is no contact at all between the condylar fragment and the mandibular distal fragment. So this is the classification of condylar fractures under the category based on the relationship of condylar segment to the mandibular fragment. Based on the relationship between the condylar head and the glenoid fossa, it can be classified as non-displaced, displaced, and dislocated fractures. In non-displaced fracture, the condylar head is in normal relation to the glenoid fossa. As you can see here, The relationship between the condylar head and the glenoid fossa remains the same. In displaced fractures, the condylar head remains within the confinement of the fossa, but there is alteration in the joint space. The normal anatomy is not being seen here. There is displacement or there is change in the relationship between the condylar head and the glenoid fossa. There is change in the joint space. And in dislocated fractures, the condylar head lies completely outside the fossa. The usual location of dislocation is anteromedial due to the pull of the lateral pterygoid. So this is how Lindhall has classified condylar fractures based on the anatomic location of fracture, based on relationship of the condylar segment to mandibular fragment, and based on the relationship between the condylar head and the glenoid fossa. Another classification of condylar fractures was given by MacLennan in the year 1952. His system consists of four divisions. Type 1 fracture or non-displaced fracture. As you can see in the diagram here, the fracture is non-displaced. Type 2 fracture or fracture deviation. This type consists of simple angulation of the fracture segment without overlap or separation. This type includes the green stick fracture, which is common in children. Type 3 fracture or fracture displacement. Here, the fracture is characterized by overlap of the proximal and distal fracture segments. The overlap can be anterior, posterior, lateral, or medial, but medial displacements are more common. Type 4 fracture is fracture dislocation. Here, the condylar head is completely outside the glenoid fossa. Therefore, it is complete extracapsular fractures. Again, the dislocation may be medial or lateral, anterior or posterior. So, this is all about classification of condylar fractures. So, we have seen in today's lecture the anatomy of TMJ, the mechanism and classification of condylar fractures. In the next lecture, we shall be discussing in detail about the management of condylar fractures. Thank you.